started his undergrad in New Zealand, and then he went to London to pursue his PhD. Then he had a brief stint in Brazil, where I'm from, and that's not how I know him though. But and then he came to Oxford. He's written a book, and his main interests are in, well, relativity, space-time, foundations of quantum mechanics. And as Bob said earlier, the way I should introduce Harvey is just to say he has done everything. So.
Thank you, Enrique, for those very nice words. I was at a conference recently in Italy, and a prominent worker in quantum information theory gave a talk about various interpretations of quantum mechanics. And cubism was along there, along with the Copenhagen interpretation, Everett, Burley-Bohm, and so on and so forth. Cubism, I think, is making a mark in the foundations of quantum mechanics community. I'm going to be giving a critical talk today about the interpretation. I think it's a sort of a timely thing. Here is David Berman. Well, let me start with Chris Fuchs. He's the sort of the linchpin of this interpretation. He started these ideas some years ago. Rudiger Schack, and the more recent convert is David Berman. And I'm very much aware that in discussing this theory, it's a very young theory. It's a very young interpretation. And in a sense, it's a kind of moving target, because papers are being produced all the time. More and more refinements of the views are coming forth. So some of the remarks that I may make today may not be absolutely consistent with the very latest versions. Here is David Merman's recent paper or comment in Nature. Cubism puts the scientist back into science. And I discovered this week there's a new book out on cubism by Hans Christian von Baer, who is an emeritus professor at William & Mary College in Virginia. So it's getting a certain amount of attention, and maybe it's a good moment for us to take a look at some of his basic tenets. The theory is nothing if not ambitious. So here are some quotes from some excerpts from a recent paper by Fuchs, Merman, and Schack. We bring cubism to the reader's attention because it corrects a profound misconception in our general view of science, which led us into major confusion in the 20th century. Now that we are well into the 21st, and we all agree that quantum mechanics works spectacularly well for every practical purpose, surely it is time to expand our ancient view of the nature of science, to dispel the murkiness that has obscured the foundations of the theory for far too long. Cubism liberates us from the grip of an ancient Greek maneuver that worked for over two millennia. And this maneuver is essentially the attempt to remove the observer, the human mind, from science, and to talk about it, objectivity, mind-independent things within science. Quantum mechanics itself does not deal directly with the objective world. Deals with the experiences of that objective world that belong to whatever particular agent is making use of the quantum theory. At the same time, as it tries to put the observer, the human agent, back into science, and so introduce a very fundamental element of subjectivity into the theory, at the same time, Chris Fuchs in a 2016 article says, cubism should be regarded as an attempt to make a deep statement about the nature of reality. And by reality, he means here mind-independent reality. And the question is, can we reconcile these various statements together? Is it really the case that cubism is offering us a deep statement about the nature of reality, when at the same time, it's trying to put the scientists back into science? So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I'm going to put the interpretation into a wider context of the non-realist interpretations of the wave function. Then I'm going to give some plausibility arguments for the reality of the wave function. And I do stress that these are merely plausibility arguments. They're not knockdown arguments. But for me, they're strong arguments for taking the reality of the wave function seriously. And finally, I'll come to the philosophy of cubism, talk a little bit more about the kind of metaphysics of cubism, if that's the right word. But let me just say that, as a starting point, I think we all agree that the wave function in non-relativistic quantum mechanics is not a fundamental thing. Of course, because quantum mechanics itself is a non-relativistic low energy, exists in the low non-relativistic low energy regime of relativistic quantum field theory. And discussions, for example, about the reality of the wave function, for example, recent discussions by Wallace and Timpson and Myhrvold, have been making this point very carefully, but nonetheless stating that just despite the fact that the wave function is not something fundamental, that doesn't mean it can't be considered to be real. I mean, any more, for example, than the fact that in thermodynamics, entropy, the entropy in thermodynamics is not really a fundamental thing in comparison to statistical mechanics. It's still a real property of a thermodynamic system. And there are some debates about whether or not the wave function, if it's considered real, the arena of the wave function should be considered, for example, the configuration space or space-time. There's a debate about this, at least in the philosophical literature. I'm not going to go there. I'm just going to take a broad picture, a broad defense of the idea that the wave function is real. But there is a question of logical consistency here in relation to quantum field theory. Because if you take the view that the wave function in non-relativistic quantum mechanics has perhaps an epistemic status or a gnomic status, I'll say a bit more about this in a moment, a non-realistic status, then it's hard for me to understand how the states in quantum field theory, the more fundamental field theory, themselves can be realistically interpreted. In other words, if you take an epistemic view about the states in non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you should be taking an epistemic view about the states in quantum field theory. And I'll come back to this point later when we discuss the role of mass in quantum mechanics. What are the basic non-realist interpretations of quantum mechanics? Well, let me start with de Broglie-Bohm. The de Broglie-Bohm picture, the best articulated hidden variable interpretation of quantum mechanics, started its life with, I think it's fair to say, virtually all of its proponents arguing in favor of the realist interpretation of the wave function. The wave function is a guiding field. It's a pilot wave that determines the motion of the hypothetical corpuscles, the point-like corpuscles in the theory. As John Bell once famously said, you do not understand the de Broglie-Bohm theory if you don't assign a causal role, realist role, to the wave function. It's a pilot wave. But more recently, a view has arisen that the wave function in the de Broglie-Bohm theory has no more than gnomic, law-like status. In other words, it's something akin to the Hamiltonian. That's a prominent view for, let's say, on the East Coast of the United States by defenders of the de Broglie-Bohm picture. I'm not going to criticize or discuss that particular view for the moment. I'm just listing it as a non-realist interpretation of the wave function. Then, of course, there's the standard kind of, the natural way to understand the hidden variable theory arising from Einstein's position. You'll remember that Einstein was not against quantum mechanics per se. He was against the idea that quantum mechanics is complete. And of course, the strongest argument that he could adduce in favor of this position was the EPR argument, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen argument. And there, Einstein was arguing that if quantum mechanics is going to be a local theory, in other words, it avoids action at a distance, the wave function cannot be a complete description of the system. Imagine the EPR pairs, for example. When you do a measurement on a spin half system in a singlet state over here, and you choose, say, the x component, you're going to collapse the wave function down on the other system to have a sharp value in the x component of spin. But you could have chosen the z component, in which case the wave function would have collapsed to an eigenstate of the z component of the spin. But since the theory is local, nothing about the fundamental state had changed over here as a result of the choice of measurements happening over there, which means that the eigenstate of spin up, let's say, in the x direction, and the eigenstate of spin up, let's say, in the z direction, must correspond to the same fundamental ontic state. They're different probability distributions over the same fundamental ontological state. So this brings us to the recent no-go theorems. Here we're looking at a hidden variable of interpretation of quantum mechanics. There are fundamental ontological states in quantum theory, but the wave function merely assigns a probability distribution over those ontological states. We don't know what they are. They're hidden from us. They're uncontrollable. And the fundamental idea here is that different probability distributions, as I mentioned before in the case of EPR, can, within the ground, as it were, the different probability distributions, you can have two different probability distributions, for example, can be consistent with the same ontic state. So this is an axis representing ontic states of the system. These are the two probability distributions associated with different wave functions. And they can be associated with the same ontic state. And of course, some very impressive theorems, recent theorems have been forthcoming. The most famous, of course, due to Kusi, Barrett, and Rudolph, the PBR result of 2012. Other results due to Moroni and Barrett et al. And I should also, in this context, measure Lucien Hardy's work. The prospects for Einstein's version of the epistemic interpretation of the wave function are bleak. Of course, in all cases of no-go results in hidden variable theories, there are always loopholes, as you might say. But it seems to me that the basic assumptions that go into these theorems are extremely plausible. And I don't hold out any hope for an Einstein-type version of an epistemic interpretation of the wave function. But what about the Copenhagen interpretation? Well, notoriously, the Copenhagen interpretation is hard to define. There are many versions of it. I suppose perhaps the most reasonable thing to do is to try to concentrate on Bohr's position. But here, roughly speaking, insofar as I can make sense of Bohr's position, the wave function is a mathematical instrument within a quantum algorithm that's designed to give you probabilities for what happens when you do measurements using instruments that are intrinsically described classically. So there's a fundamental division between the system and the observed and the observer, as it were. One is quantum mechanical, one is classical. And it all has to do with this algorithm for providing probabilities for the outcomes of measurements in laboratories. Again, I don't want to spend time on the Copenhagen interpretation, but I did want to mention the stinging criticism that John Bell raised in 1990. To restrict quantum mechanics to be exclusively about piddling laboratory operations is to betray the great enterprise. A serious formulation of quantum mechanics will not exclude the big world outside the laboratory. Now, does this criticism affect, can it be applied to all epistemic Copenhagen-style interpretations of quantum mechanics? The cubists claim not. The cubists, which I'll say what I mean by this shortly, but the cubists claim that they have a way of avoiding this criticism of Bell, and I'll come back to that later when I discuss their philosophy. So that brings us to cubism, where the cubists, roughly speaking, I'll say much more about this later, but roughly speaking, the cubists look at the wave function as providing a probability distribution. But the probability distribution is not over hidden ontological states. That's where the story ends. There's simply a probability distribution. You interpret this in a sort of in a subjective way. Subjective Bayesians, hence cubism, quantum Bayesianism, the probabilities do not reflect ignorance over some underlying physical reality, ontological states. And so in this sense, the theory avoids these recent no-go results, PBR-type results. because the PBR results are all built on the idea that the wave function is a probability distribution over hidden ontological states. And that ontology is missing in cubism. Here are some early quotes from Chris Fuchs. Quantum states are states of information, knowledge, belief, pragmatic, gambling commitments, not states of nature. They're not representing something objective. I think in the recent, it's fair to say that in recent formulations of cubism, emphasis is put on the idea of belief rather than information. It's a belief system. It represents a belief system on the part of the agent in trying to deal with the world. Why would we in principle be interested in this? Well, of course, if you take an epistemic or an information theoretic reading of the wave function, prima facie it renders innocuous the notorious collapse of the wave function in measurement. In doing a measurement, you collapse the wave function. If the wave function is merely a statement of a belief, for example, if it's merely a probabilistic statement, well then we can simply say that the collapse of the wave function, which results by gaining information through measurement outcomes, is just a question of Bayesian updating. Nothing changes in the world. You simply change your probabilistic prediction because you've gained more information. It's not a physical process. And given that it's not the collapse of the wave function is not a physical process, but merely a change of our information, then if you look at the EPR type result, EPR arguments, for example, there'll be nothing non-local in the EPR collapse of the wave function using entangled systems. And so the specter of non-locality is also avoided in principle. And of course, if you say, well, what about the Bell theorem? Well, as Adrian said yesterday, if you're not interested in hidden variables, you shouldn't be talking about the Bell theorem. So the Bell theorem is completely irrelevant from the point of view of quantum Bayesianism. It's not a hidden variable theorem. If only life were so simple. If only life were so simple. So I'm going to come back and try to say why I think that this program, despite its prima facie advantages, might be a little bit problematic.
Can I ask for a small clarification? When they say the basically that the wave function is just about probabilities and not appeals to reality, do they mean as we know quantum mechanics now,
yes,
or as we will always know quantum mechanics?
No, as we know quantum mechanics now. Okay. So I'll come back to this point later.
Can I just clarify? Sure. The last bit is your commentary with the first three quotes from Chris. Is that right?
The first of the three quotes from Chris, the last is my commentary.
You're probably going to go with the same. Does Chris say essentially
yes,
that?
Yes, he does. Yes. I mean, this is something that runs through many of their papers. Both a solution to the measurement problem and a solution to the non-locality problem. This is prominent in their papers. I mean, this is how, this is how they're selling their fish.
Yeah, I just hope you say much more about measurement than non-locality.
I will. I will say much more about measurement. I'll say much more about measurement. Okay, look, just a sort of tangential thing. Let me say, I've mentioned the PBR results, the work by Owen Moroney as well, the work by Lucien Hardy and so on. These are extremely rigorous, impressive results. But I think it's fair to say that right from the beginning of quantum mechanics, there were very strong plausibility arguments as to why one should take the wave function as a physical element of reality. Let me just say what I think they are. I'd be interested to know whether these arguments are plausible to you as well. There's the classic case of interference effects. And we can go to the most famous of them all, the two-slit experiment. How is one supposed to understand the existence of interference? When an electron goes through two slits, the wave function undergoes what's essentially beam splitting. It spreads out into two directions and comes back, interferes with itself. How are we supposed to understand interference effects if there isn't something real in both of the beams emerging from the individual slits? So let me just say a few words about interference. Well, we could talk about the two-slit experiment, we could talk about the Mach-Zehnder interferometer, but my favorite, because it involves matter, not just photons, is the neutron interferometer. This is a wonderful technology developed in the 70s and 80s, principally by Helmut Rauch in Vienna and Samuel Werner in the States. You're sending a beam of neutrons, individual single neutrons, one by one, into a silicon crystal that's been developed as a perfect silicon crystal. So all the atomic planes are aligned in the crystal. And when the neutron hits the first, so this is the view from above, hits the first ear of the crystal. The ear of the crystal, because of the periodic potential representing the atomic organization, produces a beam splitting if the neutrons come in at the appropriate angle. And there's the same thing happens at the second crystal face. There's another beam splitting of each of the beams, because again the angle is the correct angle is preserved. Some of the neutrons will actually emerge out of the interferometer into space, and we're not interested in those. We're interested in the subset of individual neutrons that are bent back, as it were. Individual neutrons are bent back at the third crystal face, and they all emerge in the same direction they came in at. And that's an interference effect. Because you can easily see that if each neutron was actually in one or the other, if it was in that particular beam, well, you would expect it to do what it did here. Two beams would emerge. And similarly with that beam. If it was really, the neutron was really in that beam, you would again get two beams emerging. So it's not an or, it's an and. And the and is an interference effect. Well, so what, you might say. Here's Matt Liefer in his very, very good review paper, 2014, on recent no-go results for epistemic interpretations of the wave function. Interference phenomena also occur, not just in quantum mechanics, but in certain toy models, simply because they reproduce fragments of quantum theory exactly. And those fragments contain coherent superpositions. And I think what he has in mind here is something like Rob Speckman's toy model. It is arguable whether the mechanisms explaining interference in all of these models are plausible. But the main point is that the direct inference from interference to the reality of the wave function is blocked by them. These are toy models in which the wave function is not something real, or the analog of the wave function. If there is an argument for interference to be made, then it will need to employ further assumptions. An interesting recent case is not something I think that he was referring to, is a fluid mechanical model, so-called walking droplet, of diffraction, tunneling, and quantization, and other quantum-like effects. And there's a nice review paper by Bush in Physics Today in 2015. Remarkable set of quantum effects using purely classical physics, fluid dynamical model. But is this really right? Is this really right? It's true that you can get diffraction effects, interference type effects using these models. But again, so what? What we're really interested in are variations of interference effects. Like, take the following one. This was an experiment. This was an experiment done in Vienna in 1984. Suppose inside the interferometer I place a partial absorber. In other words, a device that will absorb a certain fraction of the neutrons in that beam. And I can do it in one of two ways. I can have a revolving chopper made out of cadmium, which is totally absorbing. So each neutron, when I put the chopper into this beam here, for example, the chopper is whirring around, and there's some chance that the neutron will either hit one of the teeth of the chopper and get completely absorbed, or it will pass between the teeth. Okay, so this is a partial absorption experiment. And you can arrange it so that, for example, the chopper is such and its rotation speed is such that 50%, let's say 50% of the neutrons in that beam are absorbed. That is going to have an effect on the interference pressure. It's going to lower the degree of interference, but there still will be interference. On the other hand, you can take the chopper away and replace it by a gold foil. And the gold foil has the atoms, the nuclei in the gold foil, will, in a quantum probabilistic way, either absorb or otherwise the neutron going through. And again, you can arrange the thickness of the Goforth such you get 50% chance of getting a partial absorption. The Shannon information in each case is the same. The Shannon information about which path the particle is in. But nonetheless, the interference patterns are different in each case. The interference patterns are different, and this is a straightforward result of quantum mechanics. Do the Tor models produce this kind of thing? There's also the lovely case where you can take an interesting example of a temporal Young slit experiment. You can take a chopper and put it in this beam and another chopper in that beam, such that they're in antiphase, which means if the neutron gets absorbed, would be absorbed on the left-hand side, it would pass on the right-hand side and vice versa. Choppers are in antiphase. So it's like having a two-slit experiment where you have something sliding over the slits that only ever leaves one slit open at a time. Question, do you get interference? Well, you do in the case of a two-slit experiment if you're clever enough. If you're looking at places on the interference screen, it gives enough time, it's far enough away such that the wave packet actually passes through one slit while the other one is closed, and the back of the wave packet goes through the other slit when it opens. And those two parts of the wave packets interfere. And in this experiment too, you can do it in such a way you can have these choppers in antiphase, but if you have the right kind of phase shifter, which you can put later inside the interferometer, you can restore at least some degree of the interference. And again, this is what quantum mechanics is telling us, and the question is, do the toy models really get this far? We want something that gives us all that we know about the interference effects, not just some things. And then there's a very famous experiment by Colella, Overhausen, and Werner, 1975, that's sometimes referred to as the first experiment testing gravity in quantum mechanics. But this is not gravity in the sense of general relativity. This is not space-time curvature. This is gravity associated with the equivalence principle. And what happens is you take your interferometer, you slightly tilt it. So one path inside the interferometer is a centimeter or more, a little bit higher in the Earth's gravitational field than the other path. And that produces a phase shift. And that produces a weakening of the interference pattern. You still get interference, but you get a weakening of the interference pattern. And this partial loss of interference depends on the angle of the tilt. And this is a remarkable result because the difference in the Earth's gravitational field is just a few centimeters. But it also depends on the mass of the neutron. The relative phase factor that determines the interference between the two beams, the relative phase factor depends on the mass of the neutron. Now, how are you supposed to understand where the mass is of the neutron if it's not on both beams? This is an interference experiment. How are you supposed to understand where the mass is? This experiment seems to be telling us that the mass is a property of the wave function, which is a little bit embarrassing in the Verrilli-Bohm case, because in the Verrilli-Bohm you do have a hypothetical corpuscle that goes one way or the other. It's a bit difficult to see how you can put the mass on it. Again, these are plausibility arguments. They're not knockdown arguments. You can make a similar remark about charge. Think of the Aaron-Harnow-Bohm effect. When you have an electron that moves around a two-slit system and it passes around a solenoid with a magnetic flux line inside the solenoid, the relative phase shift predicted in quantum mechanics depends on the charge. It's a loop integral of the magnetic vector potential that encompasses, the loop integral encompasses the magnetic flux, even though the electron never actually feels the magnetic field, the B field. Where is the charge? Surely the charge is on the wave function. And incidentally, it should have been obvious right from the beginning, because the charge and the mass appear in the Schrodinger equation. The Schrodinger equation is telling you how the wave function evolves. Mass, charge, and a magnetic moment, you can find interference effects for all of these, which seem to suggest that mass and the charge and magnetic moment are properties of the wave function. If the wave function is merely belief, or it only has gnomic status in the de Broglie-Bohm theory, where does the mass and the charge and so on reside? Where does it reside? And this brings me back to a question about gravity again. In general relativity, where we were talking yesterday about the quasi-classical approximation, where you have a gravitational source, team mu nu, which is actually, of course, it's quantum mechanical ultimately, and we're looking at the expectation value of team mu nu as being a source of the gravitational field. This has something to do with mass. It has something to do with mass. How does mass bend space-time? How does mass affect the metric? If the wave function itself, and its more fundamental version of quantum field theory, is merely a system of beliefs, how is this supposed to go? I don't know that the cubists have addressed this issue, but I suspect that what ultimately they will say is that the quasi-classical approach, of course, is only a stopgap. Ultimately, you're going to have a quantum mechanical account of G mu nu, and that the quantum state associated with G mu nu will likewise be interpreted in a subjective manner. And so the whole of the interaction between G mu nu and the matter fields will be described at the level of mere subjective prediction. I think that's not the way it is to go. Well, another thing that's always struck me as interesting in the foundations, a very simple point in the foundations of quantum mechanics, the wave function, generally speaking, has to be single-valued. If you don't have a single-valued wave function, you cannot, for example, predict the quantization of angular momentum. Why should the wave function be single-valued? Here's an interesting case, an example of a wave function that is not single-valued. Those of you who are familiar with the Aronoff-Bohm effect know that there's a very informal derivation of the Aronoff-Bohm effect. It's not rigorous, involving this famous Dirac phase factor that represents the effect of the magnetic field, the vector potential associated with the magnetic field, on a wave function when you switch a magnetic field on. This is a non-single-valued wave function because as I integrate, as I take my r here and I do this line integral and I move r around in a complete circle, I don't get back to the value of the wave function that I had when I started. In fact, you pick up a very non-trivial phase factor, which is related to the magnetic flux inside that integral. This is why the standard, very simple-minded approaches to the Aronoff-Bohm effect are not considered rigorous, because you're using a non-single-valued wave function. Why do we want single-valued wave functions? We want them because they only, because in a simply connected space, this is what we expect a wave function to be in a simply connected space. If you have a space that's non-simply connected, anything goes. You can have a non-single-valued wave function. If the wave function is merely belief, is it easy to understand why they should be connected, why there should be a connection with the nature of space itself? I'm not sure about that. I'm just going to throw this out. And finally, I want to say a little bit about the stability of matter. In his review paper of cubism, the early form of cubism, principally Chris Fuchs's work, in 2008, Chris Timpson raised a question related to a kind of an explanatory deficit. Chris was interested in the question, for example, thermal and electrical conductivity in solids. Can you really understand what's going on in these models in quantum mechanics if the wave function is merely a statement of belief on the part of agents? Does this really, in other words, Chris was saying you can explain why a quantum agent will believe in the quantum mechanical account of thermal conductivity and electrical conductivity, but you get no understanding as to why the objects themselves are doing what they're doing. And Chris mentioned in passing the question of the stability of matter. And I thought it might be interesting at this point to actually spell out some details related to the stability of matter. It's a very interesting story. It's not always very well told in the textbooks. And the problem is, let's take the case of a single atom, a single electron atom. The Coulomb interaction, the Coulomb force law is 1 over r squared, the potential 1 over r. Clearly something bad is going to happen when r goes to, tends to 0. Something very bad is going to happen. Well, the force between two charges at zero distance would be infinite. This is what James Jeans was pointing out already in 1915. We should have charges of opposite sign continually rushing together, and when once together, no force would be adequate to separate them. Thus, the matter in the universe would tend to shrink into nothing or diminish indefinitely in size. Elliot Leib, who's one of the major figures in recent, in the post-war discussions of the stability of matter, put it like this. The hydrogen atom would be physically unstable in a gas of many atoms. Another particle or atom could collide with our atom and absorb energy from it. After many such collisions, our electron finds itself in a tiny orbit around the nucleus, and our atom would no longer be recognizable as an object whose radius is supposed to be 10 to the 8th. Why are atoms so big? We often think of it as small. They're mostly space. Why aren't the electrons closer to the nucleus? Each atom would be an infinite source of energy as the electron gets closer and closer to the nucleus. It would be an infinite source of energy which could be transmitted to other atoms or to radiation of electromagnetic waves. And of course, this doesn't happen. The question is why? And sometimes in the textbooks, people appeal to, for example, to the Heisenberg uncertainty relation. And roughly speaking, the argument is something like the following. If you squash the electron, its position as close as you like to the nucleus, in other words, you diminish the uncertainty in the position of the electron, well, of course, the uncertainty in the momentum will become very large, and therefore, the expectation value of the kinetic energy will become very large, and that will offset the negative potential energy, and all is well and good. But the problem with that argument is it depends crucially on the shape of the wave function. Because you can have a wave function, for example, part of which is very close to the nucleus for the electron. But what happens if there's a little bump in the wave function on the moon? Now, the uncertainty in the position is very large, which means that the kinetic energy, the uncertainty could be rather small. What you need is something, a very large kinetic energy, to offset a very large negative Coulomb potential energy, so the thing doesn't blow up. So that argument really doesn't quite work. But we're fortunate in physics and mathematics to have an inequality that's due to Sokolov in 1938, which on the left-hand side is the expectation value given the wave function, an arbitrary wave function for the kinetic energy. And you can see that it's related to an integral of the wave function density to the cube, but the whole integral is the cube root. It turns out that this is enough to show that the ground state energy in a one electron atom is finite. But now what's nice about this inequality, which applies for any shape of the wave function, is that if you take a special case of Holder's inequality and apply that to the Sobolev inequality, one gets this nice result here in the brown box, that the expectation value for the kinetic energy, its density, is related to the density of the wave function to the power of 5 over 3. And the way that this is interpreted by Leib is the following. An electron is like a rubber ball or a fluid with an energy density proportional to the density of the wave function to the power of 5 over 3. It costs energy to squeeze it. This accounts for the stability of atoms. It costs energy to squeeze it. The more you squeeze the electron closer and closer to the nucleus, this is costing energy, and that energy will offset the negative potential energy associated with the Coulomb potential, and all is well and good. Now, this raises an interesting conundrum, and this again comes back to the measurement problem. The notorious collapse of the wave function, say Fuchs, Perman, and Schacht, is nothing but the updating of an ancient state assignment on the basis of her experience. The collapse of the wave function is merely Bayesian updating. It's not a physical process. But suppose you're doing a localization experiment, and you start with a wave function, some arbitrary wave function. You do an experiment to localize it, which means you have to squeeze it. You're effectively squeezing the wave function. there's going to be an energy cost. How can there be an energy cost if the process of localization is merely Bayesian update? I'm not saying there isn't an answer to this, but it's not clear to me what it is exactly. It's not clear to me how the cubists would give an account of this. And I'll give more indications later why, because the notion of measurement is very obscure to me in cubism. Now, what about, I've been talking about a single atom, one electron atom. What about bulk matter? Why is it that when I have, say, a glass of water and another identical glass of water, and I pour them together, why isn't there a tremendous release of energy? There is a small release of energy. When you think about it, the Coulomb interaction in the Hamiltonian, when you double the number of particles, the number of terms quadruples, and the electrostatic energy is quadratic in the number of particles. And there should, at first sight, be an enormous energy being released when you do this process. If this were the case, as Elliot Lee put it, if that's the way matter was, it would be very unpleasant to have this stuff hanging around the house. So what is it that stops this enormous release of energy when you consider just prima facie the structure of the Coulomb interaction? So what we want in the multi-electron systems, we want the ground state energy to be finite. This is called stability of the first kind. And we want stability of the second kind, where the ground state energy itself is proportional to the number of particles, or not to say the square, or some higher power of the number of particles. And it's a remarkable thing that it took until the 1960s for the stability of the second, first and second kinds to be established rigorously, principally through the work of Freeman Dyson. And later simplifications with Leaving Thuring and other collaborators. And again, one can show that there's a kind of a solid wave type inequality in the case of a multi-electron. What you're interested in is, you're not so much interested in the nuclei, because the nuclei have three orders of magnitude more mass than the electrons. So you can treat the nuclei as fixed in space, essentially. What you're really interested in is the many electron wave function. What is it about the many electron wave function that stops this enormous release of energy when you bring bodies together? Why is it that when you put one stone on top of another stone, you get nothing more exciting than two stones? And it turns out, and I'm sure many of you will not be surprised, it turns out that the absolutely crucial element in this result is the fermionic nature of the many electron wave function. If it was a bosonic wave function, bulk matter would not be stable. So this is related to, of course, the fermionic nature of the wave function. The antisymmetric nature of the many electron wave function, of course, is related to the Pauli exclusion principle. It didn't take until 1960 for people to realize the Pauli exclusion principle had something to do with the stability of matter. And the fact that matter is bulky. In 1931, Ehrenfest wrote to Pauli and said, how is it that a lead atom, for example, with its 82 electrons, how come they're not more scrunched up closer to the nucleus? What accounts for the fact that matter is bulky? It has something to do with the Pauli exclusion principle. So here's what he wrote in a letter to Pauli. You must admit, Pauli, that if and only partially repeal your prohibitions, you could relieve many of our practical worries, for example, the traffic problem in our streets. It'd be nice if everything was smaller. But to say that the Pauli exclusion principle is fundamental here, and to prove it, are two different things. And so here's Lieb again, Elliot Lieb. The imposition of the Pauli exclusion principle raises the ground state energy of the many-body, many-electron system. The miracle is that it raises the ground state enough so the stability of the second kind holds. While it is easy to say that psi must be antisymmetric, it is not easy to quantify the effect of antisymmetry. Even the experts have difficulty, for it is not easy to think of an antisymmetric function of a large number of variables. So this is a really important result. It tells us why we live in a world where mixing things together, macroscopic objects, doesn't create huge releases of energy. But the question is, why should the anti-symmetric properties of the mini-electron wave function depend on the dimensionality of space? Now yesterday, in Jamie's talk, he was talking about topological quantum field theory, he was mentioning the existence of the anionic statistics, the non-fermionic, non-bosonic intermediate statistics for many identical particle systems living in two-dimensional space. One of the really important results of physics, post-war physics, was the discovery that the nature of identical particles and their symmetry properties rely on the dimensionality of space. If the wave function is merely belief, why is there a connection with the dimensionality of space? I'm just raising these questions. These are kind of plausibility arguments, nothing more. Time is running out. I was going to say a little bit about the reply to Bell. I'll say it very, very quickly. Remember Bell's objection to epistemic-type interpretations, or Copenhagen-like interpretations of the wave function, that have to do with simply saying, well, the wave function is merely designed, it's an algorithm for predicting probabilities in experiments. And Bell's point was, there's much more to the world than experiments. There's much more to the world than just what goes on in laboratories. That's what quantum mechanics should be able to encompass. The way that the Bayesians reply to this is, well, we didn't really mean laboratories. What we mean is agents throughout their lives on an everyday basis making decisions about how they cope with the world. Not just when they're restricted to the laboratory. Does that kind of qualification or amplification, does that meet Bell's? Remember, Bell was the originator of the term beable. Beable. There aren't beables yet in cubism, as I've described. Not yet. There aren't beables. The wave function doesn't represent some probability distribution over beables. And I think Bell himself, my own hunch is that Bell himself would say, look, it still betrays the great enterprise to restrict physics, not just to laboratories, but to what happens inside people's heads. Much more to the world than people. Much more to the world than conscious agents. Putting the subject back into physics. Well, I'm going to have to go through this very quickly. Scientific pictures of the world rest on the private experience of individual scientists, says David Murray. Each of us has a view of our world that rests entirely on private personal experience. According to cubism, in the three-man paper of 2014, quantum mechanics is a tool anyone can use to evaluate the basis of one's past experience, one's probabilistic expectations for one's subsequent experience. And again, quantum mechanics does not deal directly with the objective world, but it deals with experiences of that objective world that belong to whatever particular agent is making use of the quantum theory. Now, surely there's a truism behind all of this that all of us accept. What is the truism? Human beings have experiences, mental experiences in the world, and they see patterns in these experiences, sensations. And the scientist in particular is trying to form some kind of understanding of these patterns that we have as human agents. And furthermore, physics is a social construct. I don't think anyone really in their right minds would disagree with that. But does it imply that we should put the scientists back into science? I think the real issue here, as far as I understand it, the real motivation really has to do with the cubist interpretation of probability. The cubists' quantum Bayesian, their subjective Bayesians about probability. Probability is, to put it in a nutshell, no agents, no probability. This is the one place in their interpretation that I happen to agree with. Well, I'm not going to criticize this. Not that particular interpretation of probability. And the way that here is put, I think, a very telling remark. Since probabilities are the personal judgments of an agent, it follows that a quantum state assignment is also a personal judgment of the agent assigning that state. because states are so closely linked to probabilities in their minds, and because probabilities are subjective, the state must be subjective. But wait a minute. These aren't the first physicists to defend a Bayesian, subjective Bayesian interpretation of probability. There's a famous example in statistical mechanics, E.T. James. James wrote some extremely perceptive, profound papers on the foundations of statistical mechanics, particularly equilibrium statistical mechanics. He had some rather strange views about, rather odd views about how to explain the second law of thermodynamics, the transition from one equilibrium state to another, for example, the second law of thermodynamics. But in equilibrium, James had a very deep understanding of what Gibbs was trying to do in equilibrium statistical mechanics. And he did this by way of his subjective interpretation of probability. But James was not led to the view that statistical mechanics is not about some objective reality. There's much more to statistical mechanics than just probabilities. There's the flow in the phase space, the Hamiltonian flow of the microstate. The microstate is an objective state of the gas, if you're talking about gases. And there's an objective law of motion that takes our phase points in the phase space along trajectories to new phase points. And the probabilities are something that the humans put in when they're discussing limited information about equilibrium states. There's much more to statistical mechanics than just probabilities. So it's not clear to me that the mere fact that you're a subjective Bayesian in physics implies that somehow the basis of physics is state assignments based on personal judgments of agents. Well, finally, two last things I'm going to quickly mention. The problem of unitary evolution. This touches on really on, I think, one of the most important aspects. What goes on in a measurement process, according to the qubits? What goes on? Here you get into very flowery language sometimes. And we'll see a little bit more later. Actually, Vladimir Vedrol once described Einstein as the Oscar Wilde of physics. Einstein had a wonderful way with words. The Oscar Wilde of physics. And I sometimes think Chris Fuchs is the Tom Stoppard of physics. He also has a wonderful way with words sometimes. We'll see a little bit more of this later. In cubism, the outcome of a measurement is the experience the world induces back on the user who acts on the world. So the idea here is, you're going to go into the laboratory, you do an experiment on a quantum system. Now we bring in the notion of the world, the real world, not us, the real mind-independent world out there. And what happens is you're prodding the world, and the world prods back, kind of like an action-reaction principle. That's what a measurement is. The world is prodding back, the world is giving you information, and that's what makes you update your probabilities, you update your states in a Bayesian fashion. That's what's going on, prodding. Now, I want you to imagine a variation of the Sleeping Beauty scenario. Suppose you're in the laboratory and you set up some experiment that produces an electron. The electron is allowed to evolve freely. Freely. And during this evolution, this free evolution of the electron, you may happen to fall asleep. And when you wake up, you discover, by measuring the state of the electron, it has changed. But you haven't prodded the system because it was evolving freely. Nothing was done to the system. There was no action-reaction on the basis of the interaction with the world. Why has your belief system changed? Now, of course, if you're familiar with quantum mechanics, you know that there's a Schrodinger equation, the free Schrodinger equation that applies, with a very specific Hamiltonian, and that Hamiltonian doesn't know anything about what happened before or at the end of the thing. It's just a Hamiltonian of the free system. With some very interesting properties, symmetry properties, for example, all consistent with the nature of Euclidean and Galilean spacetime. Very non-trivial Hamiltonian that describes the evolution of the system. So if you're familiar with quantum mechanics, you're not surprised, but you should be if you're a quantum a cubist. It shouldn't have happened at all. You were asleep. Nothing happened to the system. There was no prodding of the system. Why are you updating your probabilities? when nothing happened to the system. In other words, what we're facing here, remember von Neumann. Von Neumann introduced two motions of quantum mechanics. The first motion was the collapse of the wave function, motion type one. Then there was the evolution of the quantum system through the Schrodinger, the unitary evolution through the Schrodinger equation. And ever since then, and even from even before, this is the great scandal in quantum mechanics, how to reconcile two different principles of motion, which are contradictory. But normally we think of the unitary evolution as being natural, and the collapse of the wave function as being problematic. Here it's exactly the other way around. The collapse of the wave function makes sense qualitatively because it's just quantum, it's Bayesian updating. Why is the system evolving unitarily when nothing is happening to it? When you happen to be asleep and you've received no information about the system. Well, finally, I want to say a little bit, my very final remarks. I was going to say something also about the degree to which recently Chris Fuchs has been trying to reconcile his view of physical reality with Einstein's. Maybe we can come back to that in the discussion. But let me just finish with the question of the measurement issue. And here, I like to think of this as being a kind of a variant of Berkeleyan idealism. I'll explain quickly what I mean by that. So let's look at a little bit more detail what we mean by a measurement process in cubism. Here's Fuchs and Schack in 2004. One might say of quantum theory that in those cases where it is not just Bayesian probability theory full stop, it is a theory of simulation, stimulation and response. The agent, through the process of quantum measurement, stimulates the world external to himself. This is the real world. The world, in turn, stimulates the response in the agent that is quantified by a change in his beliefs, by a change from a prior to a posterior quantum state. Somewhere in the structure of those belief changes lies quantum theory's most direct statement about what we believe of the world as it is without agents. This is where the world is playing a role in the measurement process. Merman says in 2016, science is about the interface between the experience of any particular person and the subset of the world that is external to that particular user. Here's Fuchs in 2002. I would say all our evidence for the reality of the world comes from without us, not from within us. We do not hold evidence for an independent world by holding some kind of transcendental knowledge. We believe in the world external to ourselves precisely because we find ourselves getting unpredictable kicks from the world all the time. But wait a minute. You sure about that? What we're aware of is that our sensations are changing all the time. That's what we're aware of. Our sensations of the world are changing all the time. How do you explain it? Well, Berkeley said it's no good appealing to an external material world out there because in the 18th century, nobody had a clue as to how matter influences spirit. Of course, for Berkeley, the human mind is a spirit. How is matter supposed to interact with the spirit? Nobody knows. Get rid of matter. All you need are the spirits. So human sensations are all there are. But then the problem is, how do you explain the fact that they're so structured? We see so many repetitive patterns in the world. How is it, for example, that when another agent looks at the world and I look at the world, there's some kind of correlation between what we experience? How do you explain all of that? What's the answer for Berkeley? What was Berkeley's answer? What was his explanation to this? God. Now, scientists, and cubists in particular, tend to avoid the theological line. And they say it's the world. So that's the difference between Berkeley and cubists. The world is accounting, the way that it prods us, it's accounting for the fact that we have these changing experiences. But now the question is, do we have a model? Do we have a model for the way that the world interacts with us? And here's the rub. Let's go to the last quotation here from Fuchs in 2016. When an experimentalist reaches out and touches a quantum system, the process usually called quantum measurement, That process gives rise to a birth. It gives rise to a little act of creation. And how it is that the births are acts of creation and pack the agent's expectations for other such births is the subject matter of quantum theory. Wouldn't it be nice if we had a theory of these births? I mean, after all, we would like to have a theory of the measurement process. But here's the rub. The real world out there is not made of wave functions. Wave functions are simply beliefs. So how do we get some kind of handle on the interaction between the world and us? In cubism, I can't see any way in which you can meaningfully assign a wave function to yourself, to your brain. I don't see how you can do that. But even if you could assign a wave function to your brain, you would like to say, well, I can account for the action of the world on me because I can assign a wave function to the world, or the relevant part of the world, and I can have an interaction with Hamiltonian, and I can explain why everything is going on. But remember, the world is not made of wave functions. So I have nothing more than hand waving. I have no model of how it is that the world acts on me. And sometimes, for example, in Cuba's writings, you'll see something like, that part of the world that's local to you is acting on you. You have no idea what the world is. You have no theory of the world. What does it mean to say it's local? What does it mean to say that a subset of the world is acting on you? You don't have any theory of the world. You have a theory about quantum states and how they interact with each other, but they're just beliefs. The world, this real thing, I mean, Chris Fuchs at the moment is saying, stresses over and over again, it is completely wrong to say that cubism is non-realistic, is a non-realistic theory. But the problem as I see it is, the way that the world acts on you is just as mysterious as the way that God in Barclay and idealism organizes your sensations. It's just as mysterious. I better stop there. Thank you.
I'm going to say something very naive, but if you take Copenhagen and you replace whatever interpretation of probability you have with Bayesian updating and you replace the idea of a classical device with an agent, do you have cubism?
No, because they, again, another in recent papers, Merman in particular, has written defending a very clear difference between Copenhagen and Cuba. Very clear difference. And basically, the reason is that in cubism, quantum mechanics goes all the way up. In other words, you treat macroscopic devices quantum mechanical. That's absolutely anathema to at least Bohr's version of Copenhagen. It's absolutely essential in Bohr's interpretation of Copenhagen that there be a distinction, a conceptual distinction between the observed and the observer. So part of when you're talking about a process of measurement in quantum mechanics, some part of the system which you regard as being the observed has got to be described quantum mechanically. I mean, otherwise you get the wrong predictions. But part of the instrumentation, not necessarily the part that's macroscopic, just because it's macroscopic, but part of the instrumentation must be regarded as purely described classically. That's absolutely essential to Bohr's thinking. And that's exactly what's denied by the cubists. The cubists say, we treat all objects from elementary particles to atoms and molecules to tables and chairs in exactly the same way. We treat them all as quantum mechanical.
I have a question about the free evolution of the electron that you mentioned.
Right.
So could you define it a bit more precisely? So do you mean in the lab, or what is it?
Well, it could be in the lab, but the question is, in cubism there are two ways that, in which you update your states, right? As a result of certain physical processes occurring out there. One is when you actually do a measurement. Okay, you're uncertain, for example, about the position of a particle or the spin of the spin house system. You do a measurement, you gain information. You're going to update your state. Normally, this is associated, roughly speaking, with the collapse of a wave function. In other words, you had a had a state before that was there was an indeterminacy about certain observables. You do an experiment, you get further knowledge, and now you have a new state that represents that extra knowledge.
But is the updating only when the knowledge enters your head?
Yeah.
Not when the knowledge is out there to be
had. Yeah. It's when the information comes back to you about the outcome, then you update your state. But there's a second way in which you update your states, which, remember, are essentially probability distributions. And that is just to leave the system by itself.
Because even if you're leaving it by itself, it's still in space. It's
still in space.
You can't shield it from gravity.
Well, I'm assuming naively, for example, I mean, we do talk a lot in quantum mechanics about freely evolving systems.
Yeah, but in a lab, you can't shield something from gravity.
To a large extent. You can treat, I mean, it's not as if the free Hamiltonian in quantum mechanics never has an application.
But if, for example, Lorentz invariance doesn't hold, and there is a preferred direction to space, like...
Well, look, okay, sorry. Let me expand it out a little bit. Suppose, for example, suppose you have an electron that's moving through a magnetic field, but no longer free. Okay, so it's not shielded from an electromagnetic field. In ordinary non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you treat the field as a background classical potential in the Schrodinger equation. So it's not evolving freely. It's being affected by the field. But you're not doing any measurements on it. It's not that you are following the evolution of the system and then doing a measurement to find out where the particle went because of the interaction with the electromagnetic field. You're just letting the system evolve. Why should the state change? It will change unitarily. It'll be a solution of the Schrodinger equation with the Hamiltonian that includes the electromagnetic potential. Why should the state be changing when you are not doing anything in terms of prodding nature?
That's the answer. You're going to prod something, which is when you wake up from your nap, right? You're going to read the time on the clock. Now you're not affecting the system correctly, but it's not as if there's no information at all. No time limits.
So you're seeing that the dynamics of the clock that you're doing, that you're prodding, the dynamics of the clock is affecting the electron somehow.
Well, not necessarily. But I'm saying, you're getting new information without directly affecting the electron.
It's more related than the cloud. Why should these things be changed? If the wave function is about belief.
Well, because you believe in the free Hamiltonian.
Yes, I know. You've done lots of experiments. You've been well educated in quantum mechanics. You know all about the Schrodinger equation. But you should be surprised. Incidentally, in a recent correspondence with Chris Fuchs, he accepts that the mystery of the measurement, the mystery of evolution has always been presented in textbooks the wrong way around. In other words, it's not the collapse of the wave function that's mysterious, it's the unitary evolution.
But why is it surprising if time is flowing forwards? Why is it surprising that it changes?
Well, suppose, for example, I'm thinking about just the day before the referendum about Brexit, I go to bed and I think I've got a certain amount of information in my head. I have certain expectations about what's going to happen with the referendum. I go to sleep and I wake up. I've received no further information. I haven't turned on the radio. Why would my beliefs change? I've received no more further information.
Your beliefs haven't changed, but reality has changed.
Ah, reality. But reality comes in, according to the cubists, only when you do a measurement. That's when reality kicks in. Because otherwise, all that stuff in quantum mechanics that we're familiar with is just beliefs. The wave function is just a belief. Why should they change if you get no further information? It's an input from this prodding from the external world. Chris.
Thanks, Harvey. I think you presented very nicely some very cogent challenges to the cubists. There are various things I want to say to help clarify and contribute to this debate. But just to begin with, on the topic we were just discussing, as you know, you and I have talked about this before, and I don't understand why Chris actually made the concession to you that he did to say that there's something special and mysterious about him. So I think that has been answered already by what Nathan said. Maybe Bond's updated Bond's beliefs previously and come to the view that this system has such and such angle take. And so that commits already to some kind of diachronic ability consistency requirement. It commits already to, once you find out how much time is elapsed, to change your beliefs. So I don't think there's anything more mysterious here than that is already covered by the cases they have to cover. For example, doing tomography, operation tomography to find out what operations there are. So I don't think that there's really a new challenge here, although, as I said, Chris Somerset thinks there is.
I think you could say the challenge is wide unitary in particular.
Wide unitary in particular, as opposed to just completely positive. On this last point about Archean God and the mystery of measurement, and I think you are putting it very powerfully. I want to distinguish, and I've been having an ongoing discussion with Chris and Rudiger and John, about whether it's possible to have a much less radical ontological shift than they want to do. In my 2008 paper that you mentioned, I try and articulate there what I'm now calling a cubism light, which has basically a completely ordinary ontology for macroscopic stuff, including the stuff at the level of the operation of our sense organs. So the story about experience in that kind of picture would be just biochemical business as usual. It's true that Chris, David, and Rudiger and John want to go further, because it's not clear to me, but I don't think it's the case that their arguments require them to go further. So you can have the subjectivity about quantum states operations, you can have the resolution of the measurement problem, you can have the locality without having to go putting the scientists in the full-blooded way they want to do. They want to do it partly just to see whether it can be done. And so here I think they'd actually embrace your conclusion, which is to say that there's a mystery here, but it's deep and it's interesting, and actually what we're engaged in is the project of trying to work out how the world is in this way that's non-directly describable in the non-third-person sense. How should we go about trying to get a grip on that thing? Yes, it's mysterious, yes, it's rich and deep, it's not clear how it's to be done. That's the nature of our research programs, that we find that thing out. We don't have the answers now. We can tell you a bunch of things that we don't think it is, or that we know it isn't. But I think they should just agree with you and say, yeah, that's absolutely right. This is mysterious and deep and interesting. We have to do something radically different and new. And by the way, the story about how the interaction between the world and ourselves is supposed to go here would not be one that looked anything like introducing variables or introducing any kind of normal third-person physics. Now, that may or may not be doable. It may or may not be the case that ultimately that picture hangs together. But I think really what they should do is say, thank you, Harvey, you've articulated really nicely exactly where we think the interest lies and the radicalness of our proposal, and we're going to crack on with trying to fill this story out.
Well, I'd be interested to hear what John has to say, and in particular about what he thinks of cubism light. But what I see is I see a kind of a tension in the program, which is this. At one key point in one of his papers, Chris Fuchs says the following. As physicists, we are interested in the quantum world. And by this he means the world, not our ideas, the world. But he says, look, all that we're doing in quantum mechanics so far is a first step. We're stuck at the level of beliefs, and we don't understand how to get to the level of the world. We don't really have a theory of the world. That's a kind of a modest position. I can sort of understand it. But at the same time, we're being told that 2,000 years of scientific methodology are being overturned, and that we have to infuse the scientists back into science. Well, which is it? Is quantum mechanics a stopgap? Or is it a revolutionary new picture of the way that we actually do science? I think there's a tension here that hasn't probably been resolved. But John, would you like to say something at this point?
Which of those say is the stopgap?
Sorry?
Which is the stopgap?
Well, I mean, what Chris is hitting, I don't have the quote in front of me. But what he's saying, I'll just repeat what he says. Quantum mechanics, as we currently understand it, we currently know it, is not the full McCoy. I mean, It's not what physicists really want ultimately, because physicists want to understand the quantum world. But this theory, quantum mechanics, that we've developed only concerns subjective responses to the proddings that we get, these kicks we get when we do experiments. And that's not the same thing. And he gives the impression that the quantum mechanics is a kind of a stopgap. You know, eventually we're going to get there, but we're stuck at the moment at the sort of first step.
Yeah.
But if I take that literally, then I'm wondering why there's so much emphasis on this revolutionary nature of cubism in terms of the scientific methodology. I mean, if I really thought that this was a stopgap, I would say, well, okay, I'm adopting this methodology now, but surely it's going to get better.
Yeah, so maybe it's not entirely a stopgap.
Well, then what does that mean?
Well, maybe you reintroduce the subject, maybe you can take the subject out partially, but not entirely in the end, even when you complete it.
Okay, but the devil's in the details.
Yeah, well, of course.
Yeah.
I think the difference in emphasis is that with what one would count as being better, so you were thinking being better, Harvey, would be returned to physics business as usual.
Yeah.
And they're saying better is, no, more of the stages, and less of the business as usual. So they say, yeah, but
actually, that's
something. Yeah, so there's something radically different about the structure of our relationship to reality, or about the overall structure of reality. So quantum mechanics may be, in some sense, a stopgap, but the thought is that whatever you then move on to beyond that will not be something like normal third-person descriptive physics. It'll be some more detailed, more extravagant, whatever, structure which has the agent or the first-person perspective in, and then there'll be in it. So that would be the thought. So you can see how those two are consistent. Of course, this is all a punch, right? We're saying
right.
These are the lessons that we take from looking at quantum theory and looking at the no-go theorems. So this is what I suggested then. Here are the robust things we should take away from the quantum story of the 20th century. Don't think about things this way, don't think about things that way, lead you to craziness if you do. Try our alternative brand of thinking and see what comes out.
Maybe to flesh this out a bit more, I think kind of the deep message of cubism is that when we do science, it's not enough that we're getting feedback from the external world. There's also this feature that we have to be rational. We have to make rational deductions about this information in order to test hypotheses and build our models. But what does it mean to be rational? You have to have some starting assumptions about what rationality is in the scientific method. And what cubism is saying is that in order to progress, we have to update what we mean by rationality. We have to make it different. And a lot of the strange things that we're seeing can actually just be attributed to the fact that we're not thinking about it rationally. And once we update what we mean by rational in terms of how we change our probabilities in light of new information, things will become a bit clearer.
Well, thank you, Joe. Could be, but the rationality that's being promoted here is not a new thing. This goes all the way back to understanding probability in physics, and people have been talking about, I mean, there are very strong followers of De Finetti, one of the pioneers in the subjective interpretation of probability. It's all about rationality. This is not the first time it's been applied in physics, and certainly won't be the last time. In fact, virtually all of probabilistic reasoning in physics is connected with the fact that we make bets about the future on the basis of rational use of the information we have about the past or the present. It's not a new business. And I don't see why being careful about probability should introduce a revolution in scientific methodology.
I think it is different.
Okay.
Because the crucial difference has to do with counterfactuals and how they're treated. In traditional probability theory applied to statements about the physical world, you can express your beliefs for things that happen in terms of your beliefs about things that didn't happen. So, for example, you can express the probability for a measurement outcome on a system in terms of the probabilities that you would assign if you had measured it in some other, you know, attribute. And these are treated essentially in the same way of whether the measurement is actually performed or not. So a counterfactual measurement is treated completely symmetrically to a factual measurement. In quantum mechanics, it's not the case. It becomes important whether a hypothetical measurement is actually performed or not. And quantum mechanics is precisely the question of how do you update your probabilities conditional on whether a measurement was actually done or whether you just imagine it doing it. And I think that's what makes it different to traditional probability.
I'll have to mull over that. Thank you.
Just on that, again, I don't think that's the point, but I know what you're getting at, but again, it's not a change in the nature of probability, it's a change in the one's modeling of the nature of measurement. So what you stated about measurement is the classical notion, is just a classical notion of assumption or disturbing measurements. And then what's weird in quantum theory is that things that you might think classically are ought to be non-disturbing measurements are disturbing measurements. But that's to do with one's modeling of what one takes the role of the measurement to be, it's not to do with the nature of probability, so I think Harvey's dead right. And I think, in fact, Chris would say, no, it's just probability theory as usual. It's just there's something about the world which is changing the shape of the allowable probability distribution, which is related to the fact that you can't get a full set of measurements which are non-disturbing. So that's a physical fact.
You basically said that about kind of thing.
But I don't think ordinary classical theory deals with any mechanistic observations about kind of fact.
Yeah.
Bogdan?
Oh, yeah. I have no opinion about whether this is revolutionary or I'm not trying to become Cubism, but I mean, I would like to say that to me there is something valuable in the lesson that I read from this approach. And it is, I mean, I guess many people would agree that in a subjective interpretation of probability, but if you take this very, very seriously, and I think this is what they're proposing to do, you somehow are led to the idea that, I mean, if you really want to understand reality, you should somehow gauge out this subjectiveness in a way that you have to seek for the invariant that is there. I mean, this is how I see that problem in a way, I mean, if you work out. But I mean, if you really think that subjective, then in most of the treatments of quantum theory, you really kind of, although you know it's subjective, you really treat it, make it too serious the probability. But if they are truly subjective, then you have to see extracting what is invariant out down there. And that's how I kind of interpret the aspiration. I think that's a valuable thing to explore.
Yeah, I think what you said is very sensible. The real question is, what is the role of probability in physics? Suppose we put probabilities aside for the moment. Is there any reason to think that we should put science back into sciences back into science, putting the question of probability aside? Is there any reason to think this? If you think of, I mentioned Einstein's philosophy of science. Chris wanted to show that his position wasn't so different. Einstein's philosophy of science was something like the following. Of course there's a subjective element. I mean, science is a human construct. We start with sensations. We start with perceptions, and so on, mental perceptions. But the job of science, and physics in particular, says Einstein, is to provide a language or model of mind-independent things that explain, hopefully, why our sensations are what they are. That's Einstein's project. He talks about the subjective element and the objective element. And the objective element is all of those things in our theories that are mind-independent. Now, Einstein was this was a dogma that Einstein had about which he was not dogmatic. You know, he said, we could be wrong about this. It could be that the world is made of mental stuff. And the idea that we can explain the world by appealing just to mind-independent elements of reality may be hopeless, but So far, so good. So far, so good. Now, of course, in the case of quantum mechanics, Einstein saw the wave function as merely a probability distribution, representing our ignorance. So the wave function for Einstein would not be one of the mind-independent things. The ontological states would be, the hidden states that the wave function is ignorant about. They would be part of the ontology. But in cubism, you don't have those. You don't have those. But you have this ineffable world about which you cannot talk because it has nothing to do with wave functions. There's nothing you can say about it. You can't talk about its structure. You can't talk about the way it interacts with you. You can't talk about the way you interact with it. Because you don't have a theory for it.
They don't, but they still suggest that there's this thing in between that is sort of objective.
But what I'm really saying here is I think that this what they call the Greek maneuver, 2,000 years, attempting to explain the world through objective elements. It seems to me you've got to have much, much better reasons for rejecting that than are being provided here. But when you bring probabilities into physics, well then, yes, I mean, what about statistical mechanics? For example, does a gas know about the Gibbs distributions? Gas doesn't know anything about probability distributions. Gas just does what it does. Its molecules do what they do. So there's no doubt there's an element of subjectivism in physics. But that is consistent with Einstein's program, it seems to me. That is consistent with Einstein's program. And Einstein's program reflects what I think the Bayesians viewed as a cubist call, 2,000 years of the Greek maneuver.
So I think we should have one more question. So,
insofar as the cubists allow for a neurophysiological understanding of the formation of beliefs and rationality and so on, it will all be in the context of known physics. And by known physics, I mean as well biology, neurobiology, and all these things. And that, according to their lights, would all be couched in the language of beliefs and beliefs. It wouldn't be about the world. When it comes to the world acting on you to create your beliefs, your change of beliefs, there's no theory. That's why I say that the world is ineffable. There's just no theory for it.
John, are you wondering why someone would have something to do with it?
I'm wondering if this,
what the natures of beliefs are, and such.
Yes, if you go into this, you cannot see it in neurophysiology, but just cognitive science, software.
You use cognitive science, I guess. Bring in whatever discussion of beliefs, what the content of beliefs are, or how people come to beliefs, or other fields, bring them all in. This is just using belief. You don't need to know exactly what belief is to use it.
I think you're trying to explain all this stuff of belief function being a subjective view of connection. I have to think